Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our most awaited webinar of the year. I'm Ghazal, and today I'm joined by our investment experts, Arvind, Nilesh, Pankaj, and Chirag. Most of you would agree with me that 2021 was an eventful year. On the one hand, we saw the pandemic at its peak, and on the other, markets at all-time highs. While markets remain unpredictable as we step into the new year, today, we will deep dive into the macroeconomic trends that are set to shape investment returns in 2022. We will also discuss what lies in store for equities, fixed income, and gold to enable you to build a winning portfolio. The speakers will be answering live questions post the presentation, so I encourage you to send across your questions in the chat. Without further ado now, I will request Arvind to take over.
Ghazal, thank you so much. Welcome everyone. I'll take you through a very quick 10-minute update on what we think about the macroeconomy and why macroeconomic outcomes and indicators are important for asset class performance and asset class returns. To set a bit of context, we actually believe that India is on a cusp of a sustained economic revival. And with a bit of good luck, some continuing of some indicators, and also some sane policy making by the government, maybe we can extend and sustain this economic recovery that we are seeing. Before that, a bit of context. This is a very long chart of the Indian GDP growth. The top line is the nominal GDP, which is real GDP with inflation. And the bottom line, the blue line, is the real GDP. And you can see that since 2011-12, it's been on a downhill. When the nominal GDP in India goes below 10%, we have problems. And that's what we've seen over the last 3-4 years. We've had significant macroeconomic challenges across different aspects. This was also compounded by the fact that there was a demonetization in 2016, a GST, which had an impact on the informal economy in 2017, the ILFS and credit crisis in 2018, which again kind of choked money to the small and medium enterprises. And then of course, COVID. And we've also said that, you know, as the government response for COVID was good in some parts, but also there has been some amount of income impact and some amount of income scarring, and people have not got back their incomes as to the extent that they should have. And that is the background in which India entered COVID and the initial 6 months in the lockdown. But since then, we've actually seen a decent recovery. And India, as they say, India in two Indias, right? So the left chart shows the corporate India, large corporates and their business sentiments, and they are feeling upbeat about the economy. The graph lines are up. They're seeing better orders. They're seeing better margins. They're seeing better revenues. And the second chart on the right is the consumer sentiment, which is, you know, people giving their sentiment about how they feel about the economy or how they feel about their own incomes and their own consumption. It is picking up, but it's slow. And this kind of is a clear play on, you know, what is happening on the corporate sector of India and what is happening at the demand and the consumption. And this is why we've kept on believing that despite whatever the government has done in terms of increasing spending on food subsidy, increasing MNREGA, some amount of income transfers, I think they will have to continue to give a bit more of income support to the broader India to ensure that the economic recovery that we're seeing in corporate sector also flows on and goes in the overall economy, and then the demand and the economy remains sustaining over a period of time. Why do we believe that India is on the cusp of a revival? First point, India has now expanded fiscal deficit. Actually, after COVID, every government has expanded what they call fiscal deficit. They're spending more to support people's incomes, to support businesses, and that has resulted in an economic growth recovery. India also did that. The government has said that the fiscal deficit will remain at 4.5% of GDP till FY26. That's 5 years out, as against the initial target of 3.5%. That is a significant amount of spending, almost $1 to $1.5 trillion of spending that the government has now to spend over the next 5 years, and that should have an impact on, you know, how the economic recovery recovers, and if that. A part of that is spent on CAPEX spending, which means the government spends on infrastructure, roads, you know, ports, airports. and also they improve the health and education infrastructure. This will have long-term growth impacts. So that's been one factor where global fiscal spending has led to a recovery. And we are seeing that in India also, which is one reason which gives us that India will come back to that 6.5% real GDP growth that we think about. The other two, the next point is the on what we call the twin balance sheet problem. The left side shows the Indian corporate industry and the borrowings and net worth is debt to equity. How much debt as compared to the equity that the Indian corporates have. And you've seen it going down in the recent years, but it also went up in the 2008, 9, 10, 11, 12 capex scenario. And today we are seeing corporates are in a much better situation as this chart shows, the debt levels are lower. Corporate tax cuts, which came about in September 2019, was completely passed on. And they used that to deleverage their debt, reduce the interest cost. Corporate balance sheets are in a much better situation. As I told about, from a larger corporate perspective, large and mid corporates, listed entities, they've also had the benefit of the fact that smaller enterprises, informal companies have been impacted quite significantly. And these large companies are getting their market share, they're able to grow their revenues, they're able to deleverage. And now their balance sheet is in a much in a situation where they can increase investments and increase capex, which is one big aspect of growth. When you invest is when the GDP growth potential keeps on increasing. On the right side is the mirror image of that, in the sense that when the corporate India had problems in the 2008, 9, 10, 11 period, you had a significant increase in NPAs in the banking system. And as the chart shows, NPA levels have fallen. You can argue whether because it is of moratorium and restructuring that the RBI has offered, but still on a general basis, we would believe that bank balances are much better. All banks have raised capital, whether public sector got money from the government or private sector banks have raised capital in the market. Their capital adequacy ratios are higher, NPA levels are lower, profitability has got better as interest rates have come down. They've been able to generate profits from the government bond portfolio. And generally, risk appetite is better than what it was 2-3 years back in the banking system. So corporates are in a good scenario where if they see demand and if they want to invest, banks will be ready to fund it. Corporate balance is also better from that perspective. The other aspect of growth tends to be export. So if your domestic economy is still recovering, incomes are lower, consumer sentiment is low, but if you have global economy, when it does well, the economy can grow with the use of with increase in exports. And so as that chart showed, I'll just go back to that chart 1 minute. As this chart shows, in the previous growth period that India had between 2003 and 2008, exports was one of the biggest drivers of growth. So global economy recovered and exports recovered. And we are seeing something very similar now. Exports have done very, very well. As global fiscal deficits and government spending has increased, global growth has picked up, and which means that Indian companies can initially start, demand for goods has gone up, so Indian companies are exporting better. And that tends to have a good impact on domestic economy, because for exports, the companies will put in some capacity, they will take some loans, they will expand their business opportunity. And that leads to an increase in investment activity. On the right side is what you will have all heard about production-linked incentive by the government. Details are still sketchy in some sectors, but what we believe is the government is trying to do is allow and enable Indian corporates to manufacture domestically, sell domestically, and more importantly, export. And by giving some incentives to certain specific sectors, which are part of a global value chain. So we believe that this PLI incentive, for the capex for that to be able to produce and then get the incentive, whatever investments the corporates will make will be front loaded. And over a period of time, even that will have an impact on investments activity and hence eventually future growth. So that's the point. If you look at residential housing, and this is one of the biggest multiplier impact that the Indian economy has, is when people build houses. So right from the stage of buying that land and then spending money on construction and using all the materials that go into construction till the time when a consumer takes a loan and then there's a mortgage that gets created. And when you actually finally get the property, you can affirm and furnishes, you buy consumer durables. So it can have multiplier across the value chain, and it tends to be a very, very big driver for growth. And finally, after 7-8 years, we are seeing the first signs of a recovery in the residential housing activity, especially in the top 5, 6, 7 cities. We are seeing that because of a low, decade-low mortgage interest rate, like housing loans are available at about 6.5-7%, and the fact that house prices have either gone down or have been stable, so there's been a time correction. Based on these two, we have seen that there is an increase in demand, and after COVID, people have wanted actually larger flats. You know, people, everybody wants an extra room, and we are seeing that impact in the top cities, and eventually, hopefully, if it flows down to tier 2, tier 3 cities, that will be a very big driver. And on the right, what it shows is the inventory levels of houses, right? So as the inventory level goes down, then the builder in their mind is saying that, okay, my balance sheet is getting better, I'm selling less, I have lesser inventory, I will need to invest and build new properties. And that again creates another cycle. So we are seeing these signs, and this is a very important thing. If this picks up, you will tend to see a lot more broad-based growth recovery, which can sustain for a period of time. For all these investments and the capex that companies will do and individuals will do, you need investment, you need money, right? Capital flows. And this is again long-term charts of what has happened to foreign direct investment, which is money coming into Indian corporates, and foreign portfolio investment, which is money coming into Indian equity markets and bond markets. And over a period of time, as you can see, the level of investment is increasing. One major theme is playing out in India's situation is everybody is trying to look out away from China. So there is this China plus one strategy where both in manufacturing, in terms of you need one more facility apart from China to be able to manufacture, and also in terms of investments, you need one, again, large market which can absorb that capital that global investors seeking, either diversifying away from China, or China is getting too risky in terms of some regulatory risk. And India is that market. India is large. India has a very large equity market in terms of market cap, fairly large bond market, which is opening up in a big manner. Real estate is significant. Infrastructure is, you know, the demand is it has a significant demand. And as this capital flows, and this requires sane policies, you know, very clear taxation, very clear policies into how do you attract that money. And as this comes in, we will also get the capital to be able to support. Despite all the money that we've got, India is still underinvested. Like, you know, if I look at the global portfolio, the allocation to India is less than 0.5% in any global, you know, portfolio. So, you know, India still has a lot of significant scope for them to increase their investment and for India to receive and grow that capital. And capital availability is important. So, which is why I said that as you make investments, investments drives activity, investments increase the potential growth, and this is how the growth recovers. So as this chart shows, this is private corporate capex, means companies investing in land, building, machinery, and producing. And household capex largely is residential. So if we are maybe at the sign where both these have bottomed out, and over a period of time, with some luck, with some sane policies, and with this windfall that I spoke about, the 4 or 5 windfalls, we should be able to revive. Now, and that has a impact, and I'll tell you why it matters for investor returns. Of course, there are risks. There is this near-term risk from oil prices, inflation, and then interest rates going up. But we've seen in India over a 20-year period, despite high interest rates and inflation, economy tends to sustain and grow at a reasonable pace. The third wave, as we are seeing, you know, with the case of Omicron spreading all over, maybe we are still not seeing the impact, but we have to be watchful. The second risk is what I like to focus on is the long-term need for to create jobs. And especially today, after the impact that people have seen with inflation, with jobs not being there, incomes coming lower, there is still some amount of support that is required. And as the consumer sentiment chart showed, it is still well below the pre-pandemic levels. So either this corporate capex and the macro activity, you know, trickles down and everybody's incomes go up, or the government continues to provide income and food support and MGNREGA support over a period of time to ensure that, you know, that recovery also happens. Now, why do we talk about growth? I mean, so this is our very long-term GDP chart of world, India and China, split across government. So we've always said that it does not matter whether it's a stable government, single party government, coalition government, BJP government, Congress government. Does not matter. India has over the last 40 years grown at an average of about 6% real GDP growth. And as you saw with the non-passing of that farm bills, it's a very clear indication that despite having a single party government, if you do not create consensus in a democratic system, it is very difficult to pass difficult reforms. So more inclusion, more, you know, getting more people and then deciding on reforms. That's why coalition governments tend to do better in terms of GDP growth as this data shows over a period of time. But it really does not matter. Indian policy reforms are in a path that needs to be followed. And this is also one reason why India is not China. India cannot grow at that 9% level that China did, but India can grow at 6-6.5% on a sustainable basis. And if, as I said, if those, you know, with some luck, with some macro windfalls, maybe for a near term, we may be able to increase the growth slightly higher. And this is why we talk about GDP growth. And this is a very simple way to figure out if the economy does this, what does it mean for investors? So take the case of example of equity. So 6.5% is a real GDP. That's our long-term estimate for the Indian economy. Add inflation, so your nominal GDP is at 11.5%. If revenues and profits of the company also grow at the same level as the economy, then you know that grows at 11.5%. If companies which are in the index, large companies, good balance sheets, good brands, good geographical diversification, they should be able to grow at a slightly higher pace than the economy, right? So they will be able to grow at, say, 2 percentage points more. And this is not a guarantee, but this is a framework to figure out how do you look at potential equity returns in India. And similarly, you can do for bonds. Like if the GDP is at 8%, you would assume that inflation will be slightly higher, interest rates will be slightly higher. You know, so you might get more returns on your bank savings account, bank FD. Whereas if the GDP is lower at say 4%, which was in 2019, you would expect RBI to cut interest rates. So you will get lesser returns on your fixed deposits. You'll get a lesser returns on your bank savings, but you'll make money on your bond funds. So this is the way to think about returns. And that's why the basis of where it comes from the economy is that's the reason we talk about it. In terms of now that you figure out, okay, what is the economic recovery? What is the indicator? What can I expect from returns? You now think about how do you allocate? And this is a very simple way that we've figured out for investors to think about how they want to invest their money without getting too much complicated. So the 12-20-80, as it is called, the 12 is 12 months of expense. So in your mind, you figure out what is your yearly expense. And keep that yearly expense separate. That's your emergency corpus, sacred money. We will recommend you to keep in the quantum liquid fund, but you can keep it in the bank savings account. You can keep it under your mattress. It should be at a place where it has no risk. So whenever you have an emergency, like in the lockdown, you lose your job or you lose your income, you can dip into that emergency corpus and use that money. The rest of the money, you will allocate 20% in gold and 80% in equities. And the speakers next, Pankaj, Nilesh and Chirag will tell you about why you should invest in gold, why you should invest in liquid, what is emerging, and how do you look at investing in equities over a period of time to achieve this 12-20-80 asset allocation strategy. Thank you.
Thank you, Arvind. That was a comprehensive macroeconomic outlook. Like you said, we will now get into the specifics of each asset class and also understand how they fit into the asset allocation framework. So now I request Pankaj to share his views on fixed income.
Thank you, Gajal. Can you please move the slides? Okay. So now for the fixed income market, RBI has been the key driver for last many years, but especially after the IL&FS collapse in 2018. So they started cutting rate, infusing a lot of liquidity and buying bonds. So they bought a record amount of government bonds during this period. Now that dynamics is changing, that macro backdrop has changed completely. And if you can see this chart, the blue line indicates the inflation, CPI inflation, which is holding above the policy repo rate for almost 2 years now. Till now, RBI has looked through this number. Remember, inflation is their primary target, but they look through this number to support the growth. Now, when growth is recovering at a better than expected pace and gaining some ground, there is very high chance that RBI will start the rate hiking cycle very soon. Rates are at crisis level, and we are not in crisis anymore. So probably in 2022, we are going to see RBI hiking rate. Now, from the bond market's perspective, much of this direction of interest rate is discounted in prices. Means it is widely expected, and that is built in market levels. But what will guide the market is how that's going to happen, at what pace RBI will hike, and how much they're going to hike. Next slide, please. So what we read from RBI's statement is that RBI is still prioritizing growth over inflation. It is very clear from their statements. And it seems that they're not ready to disrupt this growth recovery to tackle the inflation risk. And at current juncture, it does make sense. But if inflation remains elevated, then they may have to review this. Now, going by this, probably they will adopt a gradual approach. This is what they have been guiding for some time. So we will see very slow pace of rate hikes going into 2022 and 2023 maybe. And it will be very well telegraphed. That means probably they will tell us in advance to guide the market expectation accordingly and allow the market to adjust to this reality, give them enough time to adjust to the higher policy rates. Now, one more important thing from bond market's perspective is that RBI under Governor Das has been very sensitive to interest rate expectation. So whenever we see interest rates rising sharply, they intervene in market, they buy government bonds to keep the yields, bond yields low. And in every policy, Governor Das reassured that they are going to continue with that policy whenever required. So we don't have regular interventions, but whenever needed, they will come in and defend the bond yields from rising too much. So that's a comforting part from a bond market's perspective. All in all, we should expect interest rates to move higher, but at a slower pace. And we should also expect this to be a shallow interest rate cycle. Probably we will see repo rate kind of finding the normal level lower than what we had before the pandemic. So the long-term repo rate average is close to 6%. Maybe in this cycle, we will go to 5, 5.5, somewhere between that based on the current trajectory. Next slide, please. Now, as I mentioned earlier, that market expected this to happen, expected the RBI to hike rates very soon. And to some extent, this is factored in the bond prices and interest rate levels, especially at the longer end bonds. So this chart shows the yield curve, which is actually a reflection of yield at various maturities. So as you move from left to right, we are seeing, looking at yield at bond of higher maturity. So the far right, you can see 30-year bond yield. And at the left-hand side, you can start with a 3-month bond yield. Now the blue line is the current yield curve and the orange line is the pre-pandemic level on 28th of Feb, 2020. So as you can see, the current long-term bond yields are at the same level what we had before the pandemic. But at the shorter end, it is far below what we had before the pandemic. So as RBI start hiking rate, we will see this part of the yield curve or interest rate on short-term debt instruments moving higher. And that is a kind of good news for liquid fund investors who have actually seen a very low return in past few years. Next slide, please. So when interest rates move higher on short-term treasury bills, that directly impact the performance of liquid fund in a positive way. So this is what this chart shows, the relation between the liquid fund portfolio yield or return with the three-month treasury bill yield. So there's QLF portfolio yield, the blue line, and the three-month treasury bill is the orange line. And you can see it is very closely tracking that. So it has come down with the 3 month T-bill yield, and now when we expect yields to move higher, we expect liquid fund return and the quantum liquid fund returns to move higher. So if you are keeping your money in emergency fund, we recommend to keep 12 months of your expenses as an emergency fund in quantum liquid fund. Though our objective, the primary objective, is not to target high return, but it is a kind of bonus if we get slightly extra on the liquid fund. Next slide, please. So the primary objective in that case is actually to keep that money safe. As Arvind said, that at any cost, you have to keep this money safe. And that's what we target in our liquid fund. The primary objective is to keep the money safe and liquid and then try to generate sensible return on this. So with that philosophy, we do not invest anything in corporate debt. No private corporate debt in the fund. The scheme invests only in government securities and AAA rated PSUs. So PSUs, which are companies actually owned by a government and where government has a majority stake. So the entire portfolio has means almost zero credit risk. And with that kind of portfolio, we have very high liquidity because these are the two most traded segments in the bond market, government securities and PSUs. Thus, portfolio can be liquidated very quickly whenever some higher redemptions come. And despite that, we do keep some cash in the fund every time to meet any sudden redemption pressure without disrupting the portfolio. So this is a fund for keeping your emergency corpus, or if you are very conservative investor, or we have a very short time horizon. But if you have a slightly longer time horizon, you can hold for 2-3 years, and you have a slightly higher risk appetite and tolerate some bit of volatility. The other product you can look at is a dynamic bond fund. So in quantum dynamic bond fund, in terms of credit risk, it follows a similar kind of philosophy as we have in liquid fund. It invests only in government securities and PSUs, but it does take high interest rate risk from time to time. It has a flexibility to change the maturity of the fund. When we expect rates to go down, we invest in long, very long maturity bonds and try to capture the gains. But when rate cycle turn and interest rates expected to move higher, we reduce and invest in very short maturity bonds and try to protect whatever gains accrued. Now, in the current situation where we expect interest rates to move higher, we are going defensive in the fund. We are invested in short maturity bonds, which are less sensitive to interest rate changes. And we are keeping higher than usual cash in the fund till situation actually normalizes. So that was on the bond fund. But do remember that it does take high interest rate risk. And there could be time when your return will be very low in this scheme. One way to mitigate this is to have a longer holding period. Next slide, please. So this is a return of CRISIL Composite Bond Fund Index, which is a benchmark of the quantum dynamic bond fund. And as you can see, the orange line, which is 1 year rolling return, has been quite volatile. But if you hold for 3 year, the 3 year rolling return, that blue line, you can see that most of the time it has been between 6-10%. Because interest rate cycles tend to normalize in this period, and you get a normalized return from the debt market. So this is one strategy. If you have a slightly longer holding period, you can look at that strategy. So that's all from my side. Thank you.
Thanks, Pankaj, for that data-backed outlook on interest rates and inflation. I will now request Chirag to take us through the next element of the asset allocation framework, gold.
Thank you, Gosal. Thank you, everyone, for joining us today. As Arvind and Pankaj talked about Indian macro, what drives gold is the global macro. What happens with the central bank's actions globally, how they kind of looking at increasing interest rates to tackle inflation. that is all will drive. And as Pankaj highlighted, there are different elements within your portfolio and each serving a particular role. That way, the gold's role is to bring stability, acting as a diversifier. When things don't go well with your portfolio, gold is the backstop that helps your portfolio tide during those tough times. Like we saw in COVID, when markets fell by 40% in that just 1 month alone, gold was one that brought stability to the portfolio. So don't look at each and every asset from a return perspective, although returns from gold have not been so bad over the long term. The main thing is it brings in stability in your portfolio. So coming to the view on gold in terms of how we have seen it shape up now, we have had the advent of lower yields. Yields in the global world were close to zero. Now what we have seen is inflation raging up significantly. We have always had the view that we will see much higher inflation. People always cited the era of post-2008 global financial crisis, saying that inflation may not be so high because it didn't turn out that time. But this time what happened is money printed by government, central banks, have kind of seeped in form of handouts to people. And when money reaches to people, it trickles down the economy. There is a bulk of inflation that will come. And we have seen inflation in the US rise to a 40-year high at 6.8%. Inflation in India is also inching higher, like what Pankaj pointed out, and it is the same thing globally. So what has had that done is interest rates, which are already low, have taken the real interest rates, which is interest rates minus inflation, further negative. So real interest rates were already negative. Now they have even further negative. If you look at the chart on the right-hand side, the red line, it has been as negative as it has ever been. In the 1970s cycle, we saw similar -4-5% of negative interest rates on a real basis. Similarly, we are seeing it now. And the last big bull market that we saw in 1970s, 80s in gold was during the era of such high negative interest rates. So negative interest rates are positive. Inflation is likely to stay longer, higher, and sticky this time around because money has flowed in. There has been $10, $12 trillion being printed by central banks globally, and that has reached the bottom of the pyramid. So it's gone to people, people are spending, and therefore we have inflation. So amidst this inflation backdrop, there is a speculation that, you know, Fed will tighten faster. Like what they said in the last meeting, they are likely to aggressively unwind the asset purchases that they have done. Unwinding asset purchases only saying that they will be printing lesser. They will still be printing until March, but they will be printing lesser. Post that, they will have to see there are two things that they can do to fight inflation. One is increase interest rates. And second is to unwind the balance sheet. Oh, they have printed so much money, bought so many assets. When they start disposing that assets, that is what we call unwinding. So we'll have to see how aggressive they can go. Last time they tried it in 2017, 2018, they could only run that unwinding of balance sheet for not more than a year's time. And they had to take a U-turn and go back to the stance of easy monetary policy. So if that happens, I think that will lead to a lot of loss of credibility for the Federal Reserve, that is the US Central Bank. And this flip-flop will lead to people moving to assets like gold, right? Because debt levels today are very, very high. Again, they resort to easy monetary policy where interest rates stay low. They start printing more money. At that time, it is when the gold will shine. So I think it needs some patience, but we'll have to see how Fed kind of goes on with their policy of tighter monetary policy to combat inflation. One thing that can deter them is slower growth, impact on financial markets. Those are two big things that kind of make them nervous. So if we are already seeing Omicron and its effect on the global growth, we are already seeing cases rise in the US, Europe, and if it kind of starts taking a toll on growth because of restrictions, et cetera, that is the time when the central banks can get nervous despite higher inflation. Any lockdown or restrictions will lead to, again, supply-side bottlenecks, which would also feed into higher inflation. And it would also make central banks nervous and make them rethink whether we should tighten monetary policy or not. So there is a risk. We are already seeing some signs, early signs of growth becoming softer than what we have seen over the last 1.5 years. And if that growth momentum slows, again, central banks will kind of wait and watch. So so it all depends on how growth pans out, how aggressive the central banks stay, how higher the inflation remains. That will say that how the central bank actions will feed into gold prices. So overall, it looks like next few months could be conflicting forces impacting gold. And if you look at, so gold kind of remain range bound for next few months, because there is one side inflation, lower real rates. One side, there is a Fed saying that we are kind of going aggressive on monetary policy. We are trying to hike rates. So those conflicting forces, which is also helping the dollar, because the US is one of the earliest central banks, like UK also did, but it's ahead of the European counterpart in saying that we will unwind balance sheet, we're kind of looking at raising rates, and therefore it is leading to some strength in the dollar. But again, given the deficit spending, they just did an infrastructure bill, they are planning to do a social bill, so that deficit spending will keep the dollar under pressure. So overall, next few months could be range bound for gold. Going beyond that, we expect pressure on economy, pressure on markets of lower liquidity, higher rates. The amount of printing that we have seen over last 1.5 years or 2 years has had a lot of malinvestments going in the global economy overall. Whenever liquidity starts becoming tighter, the tap slows down or shuts off, and rates start increase, all those malinvestments go belly up. And therefore, there is a cascading impact on risk appetite, on how the economy will behave, et cetera. So overall, next few months, you could have to be patient, but any opportunity you get, you can add to build your 20% gold exposure that we're talking about. And post that, I think gold prices should start doing well. One barometer that suggests that, you know, gold prices are kind of sort of undervalued is the increase in money supply, because gold at the end of the day is a monetary asset. Over long periods, it has kept pace with the amount of money being printed by central banks, which is the red line. And the orange line is gold prices, or the yellow line is the gold prices. So if you look at the gold prices are below, much below that red line today. And if over a period of time, this chart is true and gold as a monetary asset catches up to money supply, then we will see higher gold prices. So when this catch up will happen, we don't know, but hopefully, driven by higher money supply that we have seen, supported by lower real rates, this should catch up over a period of time. So overall, this makes us a little bullish on gold, but next few months, it will be a wait and watch approach. We'll test your patience. We don't expect much downsides, but overall, I think it's a good time to build your allocation to gold. With that, I think we have the Quantum Gold ETF, where you can put in 20% of your investment in gold. What we did is recently we did a split of the denomination of gold from 0.5 gram denomination to 0.01 gram. When we launched in 2008, we were the lowest denomination gold ETF. As gold prices have increased, their denomination has increased for anyone who wants to buy the Quantum Gold ETF. So to make it more accessible, to make your rebalancing your portfolio much better, what we have done is split the units in terms of from 0.5 gram to 0.01 gram of gold. And therefore now each unit is valued around 40, 42 rupees in that zone. So that is a step that we have done in the interest of investors. So it becomes much easier, much accessible for you. And you could use the Quantum Gold ETF as an opportunity to invest at 20% in gold and build your allocation. Or you can use the Quantum Gold Saving Fund, which invests in the gold ETF, to complete your allocation, because that doesn't require a DMAT account. It's easy. You can do a SIP mandate for 5-10 years and accumulate your gold. So participate in gold and build your allocation. With that, over to you, Basant.
Thanks, Chirag, for that update on gold. It's time now to discuss the most exciting asset class, which makes up the bulk of our investment portfolio. I request Nilesh to take over and share his insights on the equity markets.
Thanks, Ghazal. Let's come to equity. Right. So, I mean, everybody knows there's been a big bull market going on right now. And of course, the primary driver is corporate earnings. And if you look at the data, corporate earnings went nowhere for a period of almost 5 years. From 2015 to 20, they were flat and structurally they were declining. And post-COVID, after that lockdown that we had, severe lockdown in wave one, it just took off. March quarter of 2021 was a record revenue and profit year. And barring the small dip because of the Delta wave, again, the September quarter has beaten the March numbers. So corporate earnings have actually just taken off over the last sort of 1 year. Demand, what you hear from companies, has been very, very strong. So there is fundamental basis for the rally that is unfolding in equity markets. And you're seeing that in earnings estimates. So if you see the trend in earnings estimates for the last many years, typically the sell side would have very high estimates. And then as the years would progress, they would continue to cut their estimates because the earnings just wasn't there. Companies were not delivering. But post-COVID, the trend is dramatically reversed. What you're seeing is earnings continue to surprise consensus estimates. And most of the analysts are upgrading their numbers. So the key question that we have is this trend sustainable? Is it just pent-up demand that has come in the market? And once that demand sort of abates, will earnings estimates again come down? And people who heard us pre-2020 knew we were fairly pessimistic of the GDP growth environment in that era. But now we have a very different view. We believe these numbers are sustainable. And actually, you will continue to see the earnings surprise on the upside because of 3-4 strong catalysts that are unfolding in the Indian economy. I'll just take you over those three, four catalysts that are unfolding right now. One dramatically important catalyst that is unfolding, and this got accelerated after the COVID pandemic, was the market share shift towards the organized players. Now, the smaller companies were anyway impacted because of demonetization and implementation of GST. And you were seeing a trend where the larger companies are growing faster than the smaller companies, and they were investing a lot more than the smaller companies. And post-COVID, the bulk of the impact has been taken by the SME and the unorganized sector. You have seen a much faster market share shift towards the larger players. Now, the listed entity by and large represents the organized players, the companies who have a capital to invest. And so even though the small players are getting impacted, the listed companies are showing much better corporate profitability trend. And our sense is this trend is only going to accelerate. The smaller players will continue to struggle, and the larger players will continue to consolidate their market share. They will continue to invest, and you will see that getting reflected in corporate earnings. This is one of the most important trends unfolding right now in corporate India. The second trend, of course, Arvind already touched upon this in his macro presentation, but real estate today is perhaps the most affordable that you've seen over the last two decades. Real estate, again, was a sector which is very, very important for the overall economic GDP growth. Construction is the second largest employer after agriculture. And once you buy a house, you fill it up with sort of consumer durables, you buy a car, you paint it, which again creates a multiplier effect. So we are already seeing a trend where real estate transactions have picked up. And given our sense that interest rates are not going to materially move higher, we expect this to be a very, very strong catalyst in driving economic growth. This is, again, we think real estate perhaps could be on the cusp of a multi-year upcycle. You could have next 5-6 years of very strong real estate growth. Again, this means transactions will pick up. Pricing may not, but you will see a lot of liquidation happening of the real estate inventory that is built up and new supply coming in, which will create its own multiplier effect. The third big catalyst is, of course, where the demand is going to come from. And if you see the hiring from the IT companies, you saw a takeoff after COVID. Suddenly people realized you needed to have a much better IT infrastructure, and you need to be a lot more visible on the digital era. And if you talk to any company in the IT space, there is a desperate demand to hire talent, and there's a desperate demand to retain talent. And they are going through multiple cycles of wage hikes in these IT companies. Now, these are not sort of low-paying jobs. These are high-paying jobs. And there is research that has been put out that for every one job created in the IT industry, the economy adds 4 more jobs because he's buying a new car, he could be hiring a driver, he could be buying consumer durables. So again, this is a very, very strong catalyst playing out in sort of the broad economy. So, I mean, this is what makes us hopeful. We think that earnings upgrade cycle is just starting in India. And people who've seen the economy between that 2003 to 2007 cycle, and I used to be an analyst that time, every quarter the companies used to beat my estimate. In every quarter, I was upgrading my estimate and just trying to play catch up to corporate earnings numbers. We think we could be entering that cycle. And there's a very strong probability that the next few years could be an above normal growth for the corporate earnings cycle after a prolonged period of slowdown. So in that sense, equities is the place to stay invested over the next few years. We expect corporate earnings to pick up. We expect corporate earnings to be very, very strong over the next few years. Risks of what is unfolding, I mean, Arvind already covered that. If there is a dislocation, and Omicron could be that risk, if there's a dislocation and suddenly you again go to a very, very severe phase of lockdowns and deaths, that could perhaps defer the earnings recovery and also create conditions where you might again get into a low growth phase. So far, whatever we've seen of the virus, it doesn't look like it is as severe as a Delta. I mean, it is highly infectious, but the fatality rate is a lot lower. In that sense, it might not derail the economic recovery like in the previous COVID waves. So our sense is you might have some impact of lockdowns, but earnings recovery will continue. You are seeing some impact of the rapid rise in inflation impacting consumer discretionary spends. Auto companies this year have already taken 4 price hikes, which is impacting demand for automobiles. But again, that is temporary. We think, given the earnings upcycle that is coming through, or a wage upcycle that is coming through, you should see people or demand catch up to that increase in prices. We do not expect that to derail the economic recovery. The big other question is valuations. I mean, do valuations justify allocation to equities? Our sense is that valuation number is slightly elevated because you've had lockdowns in the last 12 months, which have impacted earnings. So in a normalized number, perhaps the P multiple is 10-15% lower than where it is right now. But what it is also telling you is that people are factoring strong earnings growth ahead, and you are entering a phase of perhaps 4-5 years of very strong earnings growth, and that valuation. So if you look at forward P multiples, they're dropping quite dramatically. So despite the high valuations, we think equity allocation is important. We do not think now is a phase where you remove or reduce our equity allocation. We think it could be a misnomer, or it could be perhaps not the correct strategy. Like in 2005, we had a strong rally in 2004-05, and people thought now is the time to remove money from equities, but the rally continued till 2008. So in that sense, you could be heading into a very similar phase, that 2003 to 2008 cycle, and you will see equity markets perhaps do well over the next few years. The other question is, given the rally, do you wait for a correction or do you allocate now? I mean, that is where value investing comes in, right? We build a portfolio factoring the risk of overvaluation. So if you look at the long-term equity value portfolio today, it is trading at 39% discount to the trailing 12 months earnings of the index and 34% discount to 1 year forward earnings of the P multiple of the index. So if you're buying the long-term equity value fund today, you're buying it 39% cheaper than the index. So hopefully if there is a dislocation, the market corrects, we fall a lot less and give you that downside protection. But make no mistake, the portfolio is geared towards an economic recovery. Our largest allocation remains consumer discretionary and financials, which will remain strong drivers of earnings growth over the next few years. So it not only gives you downside protection, but also gives you upside potential if the economy were to rebound. No matter how much we love the value strategy, we've always advised investors to have 15% of their overall allocation to our long-term equity value fund. 85% should be in other funds to diversify away from the style risk which value brings. I'll again hand over to Ghazal to give you the allocation profile for the other 85%. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Nilesh. Thanks for sharing your outlook on equities. Chirag, can I request you to take us through the other ways our investors can take exposure to equities?
Sure, absolutely. And we say that, you know, a large portion of your equity allocation has to be spread across different styles, across different fund managers to give you that diversification that you're looking for. Why do people invest through mutual funds? Because they either don't have time, inclination, or expertise to do that research that is required when you put your hard-earned money to work. And that is why they come to mutual funds. Similarly, when you have so many equity funds out there, which is the best fund through which you can build your portfolio? Which are the few schemes that you invest in and build your portfolio for the long term that give you diversification, professional research and management in choosing those schemes that will deliver well, or consistent performers that will do well over the long run? Something that is cost efficient and you can, you know, even with a limited capital, you can invest in across these different styles of management. That is where the equity fund of fund as a solution comes in handy. You know, you don't have to worry about which fund to get in, which fund to get out. There's a professional manager who kind of does that for you. The scenario has been very, very different over the last 1 to 3 year period, right? Across the equity landscape, many of the fund managers were underperforming. Like if you see last 1 year, 86% of the fund managers underperform the BSE 100 index. Even on a 3 year, the number is same, about 86%. Over 5 year, you have 82% of the fund manager underperforming the index. Why is this happening? What is causing this underperformance in the mutual fund landscape? Because a performance of an equity fund of funds is same as larger fund basket does, right? Because if most of the funds are underperforming, there could be underperformance that goes into the equity fund of fund as well. And the reason for this is there has been a big polarization in the market and diversified portfolios have not done well. For example, in the equity fund of fund on the left-hand side where it says portfolio concentration, the top 10 stocks are 34% of quantum equity fund of fund, which tells you that it's not overly concentrated. It's very well diversified. Whereas in BSE 200, the same top 10 of BSE 200 make up 43% of the portfolio. So if, in other words, quantum equity fund of fund is less concentrated by 9.1%, which means it is more diversified than the BSE 200. And if you look at last 3-5 years, the top 10 contributors to index returns made up 55% over last 3 years. And if you look at over 5 years, it made up 60% of the contribution of BSE 200 in terms of returns. Over last 1 year, it's been a little lesser, which is telling you that the rally is becoming more broad-based because earnings are coming through. Whenever there is a broad-based economy doing well, whenever earnings are increasing, that is the time when there is overall performance kicking in, which was not the case over the last 3-5 years. But over the last 1 year, we are seeing signs of sense of that happening. And that is why over the last 1 year, it's been less polarized and more, the contribution of the top 10 is lesser in BSE 200 as opposed to what it was in over a 5 or 3 year period. Still over a 1 year period, there have been certain companies like, for example, in the bottom table, you have the Adani Group companies or the Tata Group companies doing well and contributing or are large gainers. But from a contribution perspective, we are seeing that broad basing happening. And that is why we anticipate if this continues, the polarization will go off, there will be broad based rally and the fund mutual funds will start doing well. So with that background, how does quantum equity fund of fund help you to complete your big pie of your equity investing? Is simplify your investing need from selecting from 500 plus equity schemes to narrow it down to 5 to 10 funds that you can own for your portfolio. Yeah, you get a research-based selection, you get funds that are consistent performers across market cycles, because that is one of the key ingredients that goes into selection of funds. We kind of try and meet the fund manager to identify which fund you should invest in, which fund you should not. We try to avoid concentration, so strike a balance between risk and return. So you get one fund which you can invest, track, and solve your investing needs. The performance over the last 1 year has picked up. BSE 30 index has about 30.5% returns. This fund has a 35.5% return. BSE 200 is slightly better at 36.3%. But again, as we are seeing, as opposed to last 3-5 years, it's become better because there is more broad basing. And if that continues as earnings growth in the economy continues, we will see this differential go away and the performance really picks up because the performance of the underlying market is picking up and therefore of that funds will increase. For the long term, since inception, we do have, or 10 years or since inception, we do have an outperformance over the BSE 200 and over Sensex as well. One important thing that investors usually don't pay much attention to, they just look at what is the return, but risk is as much relevant. If you look at the standard deviation of the equity fund of fund, it's lesser than the BSE 200 index. If you look at the downside risk, whenever market falls, the biggest fall, it has lower downside risk as opposed to the index. The down capture ratio, whenever the market falls, say if market falls by 100, then how much does the fund fall? It falls by 90.38%. So it falls much lesser when the markets fall. And on the upside, it does capture much of the upside, that it, the upside capture ratio is 96%. So it tells you that from a risk perspective, over long term, it does an outperformance. That is why you have a better Sharpe ratio. Plus, it has a lower risk as compared to the index. And if you look at it, is much well diversified than the index, even the BSE 200, which is 200 stocks and is supposed to be more diversified. It does have about 87% of the stocks from the large cap universe and only 13% from the mid cap universe. Whereas if you look at the quantum equity fund of fund look through portfolio in terms of the schemes it holds and the underlying stocks it owns indirectly, 61% is about large caps, about 28% is mid caps, and small cap is 6%. So it's very well diversified across caps, not lopsided like the BSE 200 towards large caps. And if you look at the stock level, it is very well diversified with a top stock at just about less than 6% holding. And you can see it is very well diversified in top 10, just making about 34% of the total. If you look at like what Nilesh said, like what Arvind said, economy looks like poised on the upside. There are levers, there are catalysts in place. So if the economy is likely to do well, the spending will, anything that's related to spending, like consumer discretionary, automobiles, et cetera, all the consumption items are likely to do well. And as the economy picks up, the industrials will also do well. So if you look at the way the quantum equity fund of fund portfolio is poised today, consumer discretionary, it is overweight, index is 7%, whereas this is close to 12% of the portfolio. If you look at industrials, which is the 6% of the index, it is 11.5% for quantum equity fund of fund. So it is rightly poised or geared towards harping on the spending or economy doing well in the future. So if indeed that we are in an upcycle, the portfolio is really geared to get that upcycle. Plus at the same time, as Nilesh pointed out, the risk, if the risks are there, it is kind of does have a very well diversified portfolio. It has technology at about 12%. It has lower allocation to financials. It has higher allocation to healthcare. So it is very well diversified across sectors to not only grab the opportunities of the upcycle, but if the risk were to emanate, then it is also poised or diversified to take care of it through exposure to other sectors. If you look at on a trailing basis, like you saw the value portfolio, which is significantly value kind with the historical PE at just 22, this portfolio does have a higher trailing PE at 40 times, whereas the BSE 200 is about 36 times. But if you look at the earnings growth projections for the companies that it owns, it is 22% CAGR over next 2 years, whereas if you look at the BSE 200, it's just 17.5%. So if you were to look at forward PE adjusted for growth, it is a cheaper portfolio as compared to the index. It is at 0.87 PEG ratio versus the BSE 200 at 0.98. So as if you are in an upcycle, the earnings growth will take care of the higher valuation that prevails today. So overall, the portfolio is geared well. It has a high earnings growth. It is well diversified to the right sectors. So overall, if you're looking to have a big portion into equities, then equity fund of fund is the answer, because you get diversification of styles, diversification across sectors, and a very well diversified stock portfolio. So with that, that is one. So out of the 100 rupees that you kind of, or out of the split that you do in terms of 80 into equities and 20 into gold, that 80 could be split into 70% in quantum equity fund of funds, 15 in value, and 15 will be the ESG, which we are going to talk about. So we, as you are aware, that we kind of are pioneers into ESG investing, and we have a very good proprietary framework to invest. And given our performance over market cycles that we have seen, it's been a short journey so far, but it has seen a market cycle of its own, right? Because of COVID, markets fell down, and post that we saw recovery in markets. In each of the phases, the fund did well. And that tells us that our proprietary assessment of companies, the quality companies that it chooses, is really working well. So we have a very strong proprietary framework, and we kind of not only look at disclosures, we go beyond disclosures from companies. We try to collect information from various data sources, and that goes into our evaluation. We also go and meet companies. We also look at doing some 360 check to ensure what the company is saying and what we find on the ground is one and the same. Apart from looking at the scoring companies on E, S, and G, we also have a check for financial sustainability. What is the financial soundness of companies? What is the risk involved in the financial of the companies? Does it have a great balance sheet? Does it have a great track record of capital allocation decisions the company has taken? Is it highly leveraged? If it is highly leveraged beyond one time, we do not prefer such companies, and that company will not make it to the portfolio, is unlikely to make it to the portfolio. So good quality companies through our ESG framework, good checking on financial soundness of that company, and that is what results in our portfolio of ESG. And if you look at the ESG portfolio today, it is slightly, it is under allocated to financial services, higher allocated to IT from a traditional market cap weighted index like BSE 200. It is significantly higher in IT, given the upcycle that we have seen in IT, we have benefited. And if it continues, we'll benefit further. But the main crux comes from the upcycle comes through the consumer discretionary, the consumer goods sector, where in BSE 200 or be it any other ESG index, it's just 11, 13%. We have high allocation of 25% in that. Again, automobiles, which is just about 5% in the BSE 200 index, it's 11% in this index. We are underweight to oil and gas sector. We are higher weight in healthcare services, which has done well in this cycle. We are higher allocated to chemicals. One may say that, you know, we do have exposure to cement companies. We do have exposure to chemical companies. But on our evaluation on ESG practices of these companies, they fare far much better than many of the global companies. They've kind of adopted the best practices that are there globally, and therefore find a way to our portfolio. Like for cement, we are higher allocated 5% versus index at 3%. Chemicals, we are 4% versus index at 1%. So we do evaluate thoroughly these companies, and they are one of the best practices companies even globally. Again, coming to the portfolio characteristics of this ESG portfolio that we have, though on a trailing basis, it appears that it is expensive. But if you look at the earnings growth again, because as Nilesh pointed out, historical is something different. We were not kind of cheerful about the earnings estimate that were put up over the last few years, but now the earning estimates look more realistic in a way. And therefore, if you look at the earnings estimate of the ESG stocks that we own on an aggregate basis is about 22% versus index at 17%. So again, on a PEG ratio, the PE adjusted for growth in earnings is cheaper portfolio as compared to the BSE 30 index, which is at 1.05. Whereas at one time for the ESG portfolio. So overall, even the ESG portfolio is geared for that upcycle in terms of having exposure to consumer discretionary, automobiles, cement, those sectors. And if there is downside, it has good exposure to IT, healthcare, et cetera. So overall, you could do the allocation, have that 80-20 split, and that 80% into 70% equity fund of funds, 15% in the value, and 15% in ESG. And you, with that allocation, I think it is geared for all kind of market scenarios. So coming to picking the winning asset classes, because You know, we have seen that FDs have been on a downtrend. We have seen that even off late, there has been slight uptick in FD rates, but it's not enough. It's nowhere close to any the prevailing pre-COVID levels. It's still very, very low. So there is a need, and with raging inflation, it's eating up into your returns if you're parked into FDs. And it's not only today. It's been historically true, and even more so today, because inflation is at much higher levels today as compared to the FD levels. Historically, if you were in FDs, it's been a losing proposition for you. If you look at one thing that remains constant because of inflation is your spending basket, your yearly spending keeps on increasing. What was enough at 24,000 rupees in 1990 has become 4,27,000 today. So that has increased on a yearly rate of 10.1%. Your spending has increased by 10.1%. Any asset class has given you lower returns than that, has been somewhere a losing proposition, but you need to make sure that you are geared for all market scenarios. Like for certain market, certain times you need stability also in your portfolio. You don't know where that risk will come and hit your portfolio. And therefore you need to have exposure to all, but ensure that asset classes which give you below returns than your cost of spending is kind of not a good. So you need to measure that and have the right allocation in place. So FDs you can have for the emergency corpus of 12 months or the liquid funds, but not beyond that because it has given lower returns than your cost of living. Gold is very close to that. Gold is at 9.4% CAGR, whereas the cost of living has increased by 10.1%. Given the fact that it's close and it has helped your portfolio during bad times, you should have the 20% allocation to gold. And equities is where the bulk of your allocation, that is why we say 80% after that 12 months of expenses, 80% should be in equities. And because it has helped you increase your standard of living with a return of about close to 15%, with inflation being at 10%, you have been well off in equities. Having said that, you could use mutual funds to build your asset allocation like what we have said. Then this is very, very simple allocation. It has worked wonderfully well for many investors. It has worked across time frames, be it the global financial crisis, be it the COVID crisis, or be it the uprun from 2003 to 2007, or the uprun we have seen after COVID. This has worked wonderfully well for investors. And so you could adopt this with ease, with 12 months expenses into a very safe place, be it the quantum liquid fund, be it a liquid fund, which is not taking any risk, or be it the bank fixed deposits, whichever place you feel it's safe, you need to be there. After that, any remaining money of the corpus that you have, you could split 80 into equities, again, diversified into three different buckets. Equity fund of funds, very broad exposure across styles, 15% in ESG, very, very different exposure, and value, again, giving you that stability in your portfolio and that upside as well over the long term. So that makes a good mix to build your portfolio. And we have been working to ease your allocation hurdles. We are launching this on our website very, very soon, maybe as a Christmas gift or be it a New Year gift to you. Around Christmas, this will be launched on our website where you can log in. You can see your current portfolio. And based on what is the 80-20 allocation, what should have been. So it gives you the current portfolio, how it is geared, what is the current returns that we have made, and how you can use the 80-20 allocation to fine-tune your portfolio. So it will give you the current allocation, comparing with the suggested allocation of 80-12, 80-20, and within that 80 across different styles, what should be your allocation? And with a few clicks, you will be sorted into the right allocation that you should have for the long term. So you could easily diversify using this wonderful style of 12-80-20 that has worked well across cycles. And you will be able to do it with real ease. Comparing the portfolio, few clicks, you sorted and you could rebalance the portfolio to the right strategy. And any further investments, you can easily mold it into the 12-80-20 style, and that makes your investing life very, very easy, giving you time to spend on things that you like, spend with your family. And that has been our endeavor with the investor first approach. And we will try and continue to get your feedback to further enhance this on our website, on our portal. So with that, I will hand it over back to you, Ghazal, to take it forward.
Thanks, Chirag. Thank you to all our speakers for sharing their research-backed insights with us today. It is indeed imperative to build a diversified portfolio that has the potential to withstand market tribulations as well as grow wealth. Now, let's take some questions that have come in from our viewers. I'll start with you, Arvind. As the US Fed tightens liquidity, what do you think will be the impact on Indian markets in the near to midterm?
The US Federal Reserve is the banker of the whole world in some sense, right? They control the US interest rate, which is the benchmark for global interest rates. And that also has an impact on the US dollar, which becomes a global currency against which everything is pegged. So when interest rates in the US go up, investors who have looked out for returns and invested across various geographies, different asset classes, will kind of take a call saying that if I'm getting a slightly higher return on my dollar government bond or a US government bond, why do I need to take that excess risk? So, you know, that comes about. And the other thing, as you said about liquidity, is when, so the US Federal Reserve also post COVID has, you know, increased liquidity in a huge manner. And whenever they, so when they hike interest rates, they don't take out liquidity, but whenever they decide to take out liquidity, that amount of excess money is lesser available in the global market. And so emerging markets typically benefit when US cuts interest rates and increases liquidity, because that money flows into higher return seeking investment. And then as they take it out, it creates a risk. So that is the background. I think we are very, very clear that the Fed's priority is inflation. They will be hiking interest rates. The inflation is at a much higher level than what they want. And the Fed governor's statements are very clear that, you know, even if Omicron is relatively the way it was, the way the Delta way was, they will kind of ignore it. If inflation remains higher, they will prioritize inflation over employment also. So US interest rates are going up. The thing, the way to see about India is what kind of defense mechanisms, what kind of macro scenario are we prevailing? So as we said, the economy is in a much better situation than what it was, say, in 2017, 18, 19, right? Or in 2012, 13, this was the earlier time when the Fed hiked interest rates and took out liquidity, and India had a huge problem in 2010, 12, 13. The economy is in a much better situation, so we are that much better prepared. The RBI's forex reserves are at a much higher level to be able to withstand any short-term money going out. And we are already seeing some effects, foreign portfolio selling in the equity markets, but the reserves are at a level that give us some comfort. Inflation in India is rising, but it is not as bad as it was in 2011, 2012. We were double-digit inflation, whereas right now we are it's increasing, but it's lesser. Is shaky. If oil goes $85-$90, then along with US interest rates hike and a double whammy of oil, you might see short-term volatility. You might see a short-term correction in the equity markets. You will also see RBI having to hike more than what the market is pricing. Right now, RBI is actually not even talking about rate hikes. But when the Fed hikes, the RBI will have no choice but also to start hiking. If the scenario gets bad and oil prices go up a lot more, then they will have to. So that has the short-term risk. But other than that, I think India is in a much better position to handle a US interest rate increase and liquidity tightening as compared to what we were in 2012. So slightly better, but you'll have to guard for short-term pullbacks. If it's only a short-term trend and whatever we've laid down, whatever Nilesh told in terms of corporate earnings, whatever I told in terms of the economic recovery becoming stable, those are all opportunities. If any large market correction, both in the interest rates as well as equity, those are all opportunities for people to allocate more into those asset classes.
Sure. Thanks, Arvind. Coming to you, Pankaj. So like Arvind mentioned, interest rates in India will also inch up following the trend of rising interest rates in the US. So that may hurt long duration fixed income portfolios like the Quantum Dynamic Bond Fund. So what is your view on this?
So good thing about Quantum Dynamic Bond Fund is that I have flexibility to change the portfolio's maturity profile. So given that interest rates are expected to move higher, we have already reduced the portfolio maturity. We are invested in very short maturity bonds and also holding cash. So overall, we expect the longer in bonds to remain anchored around current layers. There will be some pressure on the higher side, but still, it won't be like what we expect at the shorter end of the bond curve. But there is very high uncertainty about this policy transition. So we had a very easy monetary policy, and now we are going into tightening phase. And most of the time, this transition gets chaotic. So that is the only thing which is worrying us, and that is why we are avoiding long duration bond at this juncture. As we get more clarity on that, probably we will move to a slightly longer duration and expect longer maturity bonds and move out of this defensive positioning. But from investors' point of view who are considering dynamic bond fund, remember we are positioned defensively, and much of our portfolio is into shorter maturity bonds.
Thanks, Pankaj. Coming to you, Chirag. So rising interest rates will strengthen the US dollar, which is not good news for gold. But on the other hand, there is a theory that volatile equity markets, you know, might actually help the metal to go up. So how do you foresee both these claims, and which one is true in your opinion?
Yeah, sure. So rising interest rates is will help the dollar only initially, because US is kind of leading the pack in terms of, you know, saying that we'll unwind the balance sheet and, you know, we'll increase interest rates. But over time, the European Central Bank, et cetera, will kind of, you know, catch up. So one is that, which will have lead to a temporary strength in the dollar initially, post which it will kind of subside. Second is, if you look at today, whatever we were seeing on the monetary front has now been, the baton has been passed on the fiscal front. They are doing an infrastructure bill. They are doing talking about a social bill. So they are kind of still in the mode of supporting the economy to the fiscal side. And that will lead to, that will lead to this deficit spending will again fundamentally put pressure on the dollar. So overall, we do not anticipate a runaway strength in the dollar. It could be only for short term, and post the short term, we expect that the dollar should again start weakening. Second is on the equity side, there is volatility in markets. Of course, gold gets bids under because people kind of try to move or get risk averse and try to move to safer assets. And therefore, there will be bids coming in for gold. So there are conflicting factors over the short run. And dollar strength is one of the things that will limit gold's rise in the short term. But beyond that, we don't anticipate the dollar slide. And if there is impact of lower liquidity, rising rates on equity markets, again, gold will get further supported. So barring the near term and the conflicting factors that it kind of sees, gold should start doing well.
Sure. Thanks, Chirag. Nilesh, the next question is for you. So a recent article mentioned that the era of free money is behind us and value as an investment strategy should do well going forward. So based on this, can we expect the Quantum Long-Term Equity Value Fund's performance to improve?
I don't know whether the era of free money is behind us. Like Arvind suggested, even the Indian Central Bank perhaps leans more towards growth. And if there is any sort of hindrance towards growth, they are very, very cautious about raising interest rates, and they might even cut interest rates. Having said that, I do agree that the time for value perhaps over the next 4-5 years, the return potential of value strategy will be a lot better. Now, you have to, just to go back in history, why did value not do well, especially in the Indian context? In that 2017 to 19 period, it was a very low growth environment for India. And value companies, value style traditionally tends to buy sensible managements at valuations that they think are reasonably attractive, and hoping that as the earnings potential plays out, these companies will get re-rated. But in a low growth environment, earnings growth was very, very slow. And in that environment, the small set of companies that were showing marginally higher growth, even though it was a lot lower than their own historical growths, got re-rated quite dramatically. And they were the ones who essentially drove the equity rally. But it was a very, very small set of stocks. In an environment where there's a broad-based economic recovery and all the companies are essentially growing because there is economic growth, the premium accorded to the growth companies tends to come down, and the value companies tend to catch up to the valuation multiples that they were trading at historically. That era perhaps is going to play out over the next 4-5 years. And in that environment, given the portfolio that we've built, which is at a sharp discount to index valuations, and a portfolio that is geared for growth, our sense is that will do relatively well and perhaps get back to a long-term outperformance that was there before that 2017 to 19 period. So if you look at the 10-year track record of Quantum Long-Term Equity Value Fund from 2006 to 2016, in fact, across time horizons, be it 3-year, 5-year, 7-year, 10-year, at the end of 2016, we were in the top five across categories. It is only the 2017 to 19 period that a performance got hit because of the reasons that I stated. But if we get back to the broad-based economic recovery environment, at least our expectation is the value strategy will do well. And within that, the Quantum Long-Term Equity Value Fund, which has been value right from day one and sort of focuses on buying companies at deep discounts, that should do well. Hopefully, our outperformance should come back over the next few years.
Thanks, Nilesh. Coming back to you, Pankaj, what are your views on target maturity funds more so in the current times?
Yeah, in an environment where interest rates are rising, target maturity funds where you are investing for a slightly longer period and you are ready to hold for that period, that makes sense. But I think in the same way, other funds where if you are having a longer holding period, there are other options as well in the debt fund space. So as I shown in my slides earlier, that over the period, over a 3-4 year horizon, returns tend to normalize. So if you have slightly higher holding period, you can invest in any bond fund. And especially in this environment where things are pretty uncertain, I think dynamic bond funds are very well placed. Here we have flexibility. We don't know how things will evolve. This is a big transition, what is happening. And we don't know at what point monetary authorities can even take U-turn. So it makes sense to have a long holding period money going into dynamic bond fund. Then locking it in any other category. So I think these are better positioned.
Thanks, Pankaj. Coming to you, Arvind. So the question is, why are FIIs selling in Indian markets over the last few months? Because it doesn't resonate with the view that, you know, with China slowing down, India would become a more attractive investment destination. So what are your views on that?
These short-term inflows, outflows are also always a relative play. If I look at over the last 5 years, if I look at pick any global emerging market fund which has an allocation to India, between 2015 and 2018-19, their allocation to India was coming down. Traditionally, global emerging markets funds have always had an over-allocation to India. So if India's weight in MSCI is 9%, they would technically have more than 9% in their emerging market portfolio because India had size, growth, opportunity, good quality companies, very good managements than say other emerging markets. But in 2015 to 19, we've seen that over allocation to India coming down. And it's only in 2019 that we actually saw emerging market managers increasing the allocation to India. Could be because of the prospect of higher growth, could be diversifying away from China. And that's why you saw a significant increase in the flows over the last 1.5 years, right? FPI equity flows have been the highest over the last 18-month period. Some of that is going out. Now, it could be because of valuations, as Nilesh pointed out. It could be because China has corrected so much that their relative attraction or relative valuation is kind of better considering all the risk. So these are all short-term phenomena, and it gives you opportunities. It takes away opportunities depending on how fast and how much they buy and sell. But the broader point still remains that in a global portfolio, if I look at the global pension funds, you know, global sovereign wealth funds, university endowments, insurance companies, if I look at their portfolio and their allocation to India, it's less than 0.5% of their money is invested in India. So despite all this inflow, outflow and the charts that I showed, India still will secularly only get money. This short-term phenomenon could be anything, as I said, valuations, relative valuations, maybe a relative attractiveness somewhere else. If you look at other emerging market currencies, they've actually depreciated quite a bit more than what India has done. And this has been true for the last 5-7 years now. So when currencies also correct a lot, that also gives you slightly higher valuation. Like if Indian rupee corrects to say 80, 81, the allocation for the foreigner that much becomes that much more attractive. So now these things come into play. But if you're a long-term investor, you should believe that India will secularly receive more and more money from foreigners.
Thanks, Arvind. Coming to you, Chirag, you recently changed the face value of the Quantum Gold ETF. Can you tell us about that and what would be its impact, or how does it benefit investors?
So as you're aware, that when Quantum Gold ETF was launched, it was one of the lowest denominated ETF at 0.5 gram of gold. Investors wanted to, you know, further have lower, because gold prices have risen significantly from there. When we launched, I think it was about 500, 600 rupees per unit. Now it had increased to 2100, 2200 rupees per unit. So it was getting a little unaffordable for many who kind of bought regularly small units of gold. So for all those investors, given that we believe in investor first and try to make investing easy for them, we kind of lowered that 0.5 gram denomination to 0.01 gram. And therefore the face value also adjusted, which is 100 rupees face value, to 2 rupee face value. So your investment value still remains the same. Only thing is your per unit value has come down, your NAV has come down, but you got more units because of the split that happened in face value. So with this, your investing further becomes more accessible for many investors. Your rebalancing becomes that much more efficient whenever you want to do it. So in line with that, as I said, there is more impact on your total investment value because your lower NAV has been equally compensated with higher increase in number of units. So that has been the move. And you would have seen the trading on the exchanges of the ETFs which was around 2100 or around that price, has come down to around 41, 42 rupees. So that is just because the denominations have changed from 0.5 gram to 0.01 gram. And from now onwards, each unit will continue to represent 0.01 gram of gold. So from an investor perspective, no change in investment value, only lower the denomination for the Quantum Gold ETF.
Thanks, Chirag. Nilesh, the next question is for you. With Omicron causing panic in equity markets, do you think it's a good time to enter the markets, or should one wait for further correction?
Yeah, it's early days because of Omicron, but the correction has still not been that severe. It's just been about 10%. Whatever data that we have seen of Omicron suggests that it is a highly infectious variant, but it's a mild variant. It does not cause the kind of fatalities that we saw with the Delta variant. So I'm not sure we might see any major significant correction, unless of course data dramatically changes and we come to know it is a lot more stronger variant. But my sense is not try to time markets because of these events. I think if you just stick to your long-term asset allocation plans and let the asset classes do what they do over a long period of time, I think that is a better strategy. I think someone who's not invested, I think when we look at the upside potential of the value strategy, where we look at our sell limits, they are in line with the long-term averages of the strategy that we've seen since inception. So So I think even currently, it's a good time to go ahead and invest in equity markets. You might have some volatility, but I think over the next 5 years, 10 years, I think returns would be in line with what you've experienced with equities as an asset class over the last sort of many years, including the since inception kind of returns that you've seen in quantum long-term equity value fund. So irrespective of the Omicron variant and how it plays out, I think today is a good time to start investing in equities and then just stick to your long-term asset allocation plan and ignore volatility that might come through.
Thanks, Nilesh. Pankaj, some fund-specific questions coming your way. Is this the right time to invest in dynamic bond fund, or should the investor wait till interest rates rise?
So again, as Nilesh said, we should stick to our long-term asset allocation. And as we recommend this 12-20-80 approach, investors who are keeping short-term cash or keeping their emergency fund, they should stick to liquid fund, whatever be the cycle. But if you have some residual money and you want to put it in the fixed income space, dynamic bond funds, remember, because rates are rising, next 1 year could be challenging. We don't know how things will evolve. Nobody knows. So that will be a big challenge. However, if you have a long-term horizon, I think returns will be closer to what we get in fixed income space if we take a slightly broader view and consider all other options like fixed deposits, etc. So first, you need to have a longer time horizon if you are coming into dynamic bond fund. The other thing is be prepared for some volatility. There will be a time when you see even a negative return on the fund, but make sure you don't panic to that situation. And remember, while when you invested with a slightly longer holding period. And you do get a tax advantage if you hold for a more than 3 year period. So that can contribute to your return as well. So just have a longer holding period if you're investing, but otherwise the core portfolio should be following that 12-80-20 approach as a long-term asset allocation.
And Pankaj, does the quantum liquid fund allow instant redemption, or is there the traditional T+2 approach?
No, yes, the fund has an instant redemption facility. You can withdraw up to 50,000 from the fund anytime. So it does offer that. Yes.
Thanks. Arvind, coming to you, do you think we will see India's inclusion in the global bond index in 2022? And what will be its impact on bond markets as well as the currency?
A good question. If I look at global comparison, foreigners own less than 2% of the Indian bond market. Indonesia, it's almost about 35-40%. China has recently allowed and you know, the share is increasing. If I look at India's weight as an emerging market country and what the size of the bond market that India has, in an emerging market bond index, about 10% weightage, India should have between 8-10%. So the bond index inclusion means that India formally gets included in a global emerging market bond index. So all asset managers or mutual funds or even pension funds and insurance companies who take that as a benchmark will have to make some allocation to India, or equal weight or underweight or overweight. And ETFs, bond ETFs, which track these global emerging market index, will necessarily have to buy. So when India gets into the index, of course, you will get more flows. The timing, I had a India bond fund in 2010, and even then there was talks of India getting to the bond index. So, you know, it's been a long time, but now a lot of conditions are in place. There is the RBI has had a regulation which allows foreigners to own certain specific securities unlimited, right? Till the 100% of the bond outstanding can be owned by foreigners. So that is a big thing. There is something called Euroclear, where instead of settling the bonds in India, there is a Euroclear mechanism which every fund globally uses. And if Indian bonds are listed there, then it will be easier for them to settle and trade and access. I think the government is working towards that. So looks like sometime in 2022, there will be an announcement that India will be part of a global bond index. The weightages will change. I think they will grade it over a period of time. What it does is it allows the Indian fiscal deficit, which is very high right now and expected to remain high for the next 4-5 years, will get funded by global investors. Why they are not doing it now is there are different things. India is not part of the index. Anybody who takes the India allocation is an over-allocated against the benchmark. So when it gets in the index, there will be some dedicated money. Some people are estimating that that will be about $25 to $40 billion over the next 1 or 2 years within the inclusion. And as Indian economy increases, the size of the bond market increases, the weightage increases, and you should get a lot more money. So it's a good trend. It diversifies the investor pool. It reduces the pressure of domestic banks and insurance companies and mutual funds to, you know, keep buying government bonds. There is an external buyer. But we'll have to wait and watch. We think it is a significant move whenever it happens. There will be an impact on bond yields. Market will kind of position it before that. It will increase RBI's headache of, you know, FX, where, you know, all these money that comes in and they'll have to, if they don't want to allow the currency to appreciate, we'll have to see how they manage that. But from a long-term perspective, it's great. More foreign holding is better. The Indian bond market then can access a global savings pool. But we'll wait and watch when it happens, and we'll put out a note on, you know, what could be the impact of it.
Sure. Thanks, Arvind. Chirag, can you throw some light on the parameters you take into consideration when you select funds for the quantum equity fund of fund portfolio?
Sure. So when we select funds for the quantum equity fund of funds, we do a thorough analysis of the performance, which includes risk and return that the fund has. More weightage is given because predicting the future is very, very difficult. So the fund consistency is very, very material. If the fund has performed consistently well, so that differentiates luck from skill, right? So it is more skill-based as opposed to a luck which could drive one-time or two-time performance. If the fund manager has done well across cycles, then it tells us that it is very, very consistent fund. So we can look at various risk return parameters to evaluate the consistency of that fund manager. We look at portfolio concentration. We look at what processes that they have to manage the fund. We look at the valuation ratios to some extent as well to ensure that, you know, the fund is valued appropriately at that point in time, which has a lower weightage, but still a weightage in the overall scheme of things. Then we meet the fund manager to understand their strategy properly. We kind of ask very tough questions to ensure that what the fund manager says and does is the same thing or not. We ask questions around their holdings. We ask questions around their portfolio characteristics to ensure that we understand that fund very well and it fits very well amongst the other holdings of the fund that we have. So passing all these metrics on the quantitative and the qualitative front, we do even see in terms of the teams that they have, the succession planning that they have. So if everything is well, because at times when we have seen, whenever the fund manager of the underlying fund changes, may have seen big changes in the portfolio, and that we do not like as much. So that tells us that is not much process. It's more governed by the fund manager who is at the helm of things. So we want continuity, we want predictability, and therefore we evaluate the fund managers on that basis. So overall, quantitative, qualitative, in terms of looking at the fund house, looking at the philosophy, looking at the team, succession planning, all this goes into how we kind of rank funds. And then when we are okay, we do not see any red flags, we will buy into that fund. So that's in a nutshell overall the process that we follow for selecting funds.
Sure. Thanks, Chirag. Nilesh, any views on the IPO boom and the questionable valuations?
I mean, there is a set of companies coming through, especially on the technology and the digital side. Now, again, it's a new set of companies for India, and everybody's trying to figure out how to value these companies. So some of them look very exorbitantly priced, but again, everybody's sort of trying to figure out how to value them as things go along. But fortunately, what you're also seeing is some of these companies are not doing that well on listing or not getting enough subscribers. So it's not a carte blanche boom in the IPO market where whatever company comes through, it's going to get oversubscribed and it's going to get massive upgrades on listing. It is not that. It also tells you that there is some skepticism in the IPO market. But generally, IPOs tend to be overpriced. It is not, most companies will give the mandate to an investment banker, which will give them the highest price. And they tend to be overpriced. And a lot of these IPOs do not do that well in the first 1 year, 2 years of listing for the end investor. Given that some of these IPOs have not done that well, also tells me there is some skepticism in the market. And it is not the kind of boom that you saw in 2007-08, where whatever company would come through, and there was a famous instance of a power company without underlying assets getting subscribed multiple times, which eventually sort of signaled the peak of the market. That kind of boom you're not seeing right now in equity markets.
If I can add to that, apart from the valuation aspect, the good thing about IPOs is it brings into the market different opportunities to invest. So the investable universe, the investable options, the different sectors and the competitive landscape, that changes. So overall, depending on the valuation, but it just makes the choice availability for investors that much more wider and larger.
Thanks, Arvind. Nilesh, coming back to you. So some companies in the consumer space seem overvalued. What is your view on this segment? Also, what framework do you follow to select companies for the quantum long-term equity value fund?
Yeah, these are, again, very high-quality companies, and these are companies we would like to own in the fund. But we've not been able to own them for almost a decade now. And it's not that our valuation bands are are not in sync with the quality of business. We value these companies for the quality of business. But generally, like I said, in the last few years, companies that were growing at slightly faster rate than the overall economic growth got repriced exorbitantly. So, I mean, most of these companies trade at 70, 80 times earnings, even though their growth rates are between 10 and 15%. The assumption is that either a greater fool who will pay a higher multiple than me will come and buy them, or 10 years later, their valuations will be attractive because they can grow consistently for such a long period of time. Again, being value investors, we tend to factor risks first, and we don't know what is going to happen over the next 10 years. We tend to have much more conservative multiples than the current valuation multiples for these companies. But again, these are high quality companies, and they will always trade at premium valuations. What was the second question again? I missed the second part of the question.
The parameters you follow to select companies for quantum long-term equity value.
Yeah, so I mean, we tend to look at long-term earnings trajectory of companies. So minimum, we forecast 5 year forward earnings, and we have 5 year history. And then we are looking at normalized earnings. So we will not assume a boom phase earnings cycle for a company consistently or a bear phase earnings cycle for a company. We would assume a normalized earnings growth and look at long-term valuation bands, and then look at bands where we think and decide a fair value multiple for this company. This could be at the long-term median or slight premium to the long-term median. Again, the valuation multiples reflect the quality of business. So a consumer staples company with high ROEs will obviously have higher multiples. While a commodity company, perhaps we would be happy to buy them at replacement cost or a discounted replacement cost. So based on these valuation bands, we will have a buy and sell limit for each company. And only when a company comes below a buy limit will we add it to the portfolio. And similarly, if a company were to sell or go beyond a sell limit, we will exit it from the portfolio. Recently, in the COVID crisis, we tweaked these processes slightly, where we added a bit more leeway for high quality companies. So if a high quality company comes within 10% of our buy limit, and given the process that we've laid out, it might take us a long time to redo the numbers and get it approved by the research team. We said we'll have a small allocation to come to such companies, 2% of the portfolio initially, and then of course increase position as we get more visibility or earnings. And similarly, in a high quality company, we decided we'll capture a bit more of the upside as they go beyond our sell limits, and we gradually trim them. But by and large, we would have a fair value multiple for these companies, and we will buy them at 30-40% discount to these fair value multiples. And that is how we construct a portfolio.
Sure. Chirag, the next question is for you. With the introduction of silver ETFs, should investors look at silver as a portfolio diversifier?
Silver, you need to understand that silver, post getting delinked as a form of money, is more used for industrial purposes. About 70% of the usage for silver comes for industrial uses. Industrial uses or industrial use will increase when the overall economy is doing well. And when your overall economy is doing well, your equities are likely to do well. So it's a similar exposure to the economy in terms of what your equities will give you. Silver gives you a similar kind of exposure. So overall, if you are looking for a diversifier, I think gold fits the bill better than as compared to silver. Gold has kind of, it's time tested. It has showcased across different market cycles during the crisis of the global financial crisis, the COVID crisis, it's done better. Silver, on the other hand, will largely do well because of its usage increase in industrial when economy is doing well. So silver doesn't really meet the diversification need. Gold is a much better diversifier from a portfolio perspective. When you're looking to invest in silver, silver ETF will give you an efficient exposure to silver, but you need to test it for its then demand supply, substitution possibilities, and then invest in silver. For example, if today the large part of demand for silver comes from solar panels, that is what is driving the silver usage. If there is any substitution that happens, technology emerges, there's something that is better than silver, then the demand may collapse. The incremental demand may not come through, and silver prices may take a hit at that time. A similar thing can happen in platinum and palladium, though they are precious metals. When things move on from ICE engine to EV, the platinum and palladium demand may take a hit because then you won't need those catalytic converters where platinum and palladium are used to reduce emissions. So overall, you need to be aware when you're investing in such commodities, you need to be aware what is the demand, what is the supply, what is the risk to disruption in terms of what can substitute that commodity, and then invest in that. So from a diversification perspective of all the commodities, gold is the best bet you have. Apart from that, any other commodity, you have to look at from a demand supply balance perspective.
Thanks, Chirag. Arvind, how has the rupee performed against the dollar in the last two or so decades?
Okay, so over the long term, the Indian rupee has depreciated or lost value against the US dollar by about between 2 and 3%, about 2.4%, I think is the average, 10 to 20 years. And you can actually work out that this is a difference between the Indian inflation and the US inflation. So, on a long-term basis, that's been the trend. Looks like it will continue. One thing what will happen is India will keep getting large capital inflows. As India gets bigger, policies become more saner, more predictable. India will be able to attract a larger capital flows, but this interest rate differential and the inflation, in our models, what we assume is that the rupee will depreciate at an annual pace of about 2% over the long term. Certain short term, 6 months, 1 year, we might have a different view depending on where the oil prices are. So where current account deficit is, what is the inflow outflow from capital flows. But otherwise, we assume a 2% depreciation over the long term.
Thanks, Arvind. Pankaj, what are the prospects of the Bharat Bond ETF, and does the Quantum Dynamic Bond Fund have any allocation to Bharat bonds? Pankaj, you're on mute.
Yes, sorry. No, we don't have any allocation to Bharat Bond ETF. But again, I'll go back to the same thing that look at the maturity. If you are considering long-term ETF, that recently they're coming to 2032 ETF. So there we have very high interest rate risk. And in an environment where we expect interest rates to move higher, these ETF carry very high risk. So investors who are looking to invest should be conscious of this fact that interest rates will rise and that can impact the performance of these funds. As far as dynamic bond fund is concerned, we don't have any exposure in these ETFs.
Thanks, Pankaj. Chirag, you were speaking about the 12-20-80 recommended asset allocation. So does the quantum multi-asset fund also follow this, or how is it different from this?
So the way investors should look at it is 12-80-20 is a do-it-yourself strategy, wherein we recommend you this allocation, which you can take it for the long term and invest based on that. And over cycle, we expect that that should do well. Tied over any crisis, any good periods, equally well. So overall, this is when you're trying to do it yourself. When it comes to the quantum multi-asset fund, it is a solution for you. It is a solution for you to give, that gives you better returns than your fixed deposits will give you. The endeavor is to outperform fixed deposits while only taking minimal risk. So we try to minimize risk at all times. Whenever there is a even small valuation risk, we don't take those risks. For example, today, the earnings cycle looks better, but valuations are expensive. We kind of have a lower allocation to equities. But at the same time, if there is lesser risk and there are more opportunities, we'll grab those opportunities. Like, for example, in the COVID period, when markets fell by 40%, we increased our allocation from around 25% to around 50% in equities. So that is how we're kind of structuring it, trying to ensure that risks are minimized. At the same time, it gives you sensible returns over and above your fixed deposits. So you need to understand it's very, very different purposes. One is a strategy for doing it yourself. You invest in this 12-80-20 allocation and you invest for the long term. I think it will help you tide over, over market cycles and give you a sensible rate of return over the long term. Whereas multi-asset fund is a solution if you are kind of conservative and keep risk as your top priority to minimize those risks, then earn still a sensible return, then multi-asset fund is a solution for you. So you have to very well differentiate either you want a solution or you want to do it yourself.
Thanks, Chirag. Nilesh, if a 10-year view is taken, would it be fair to assume that the long-term equity value fund would give a CAGR of 12-15%?
I think Arvind's framework of what equity returns should one should expect over a long term, I think quantum long-term equity value fund will perhaps give you a return in line with that. That has been a long-term track record since inception. So I think that 12-15% is a fair assumption.
Also, Nilesh, what is your view on the real estate sector, and do we have any exposure to this sector in the portfolio?
I mean, real estate is one of those great macro stories, but people know there is great housing demand in India, and it's one of those sectors which itself will grow. But when you come down to micro and try and find managements which you want to invest with, barring one or two names where valuations look expensive, it's very tough to find real estate companies which are very well governed. And most of them actually get rejected via an integrity filter. So one of the first part of our process is an integrity filter where we will not invest in managements where we think governance norms are not great and minority rights are not well protected. Unfortunately, given the nature of the industry, most of these managements are not that great, and corporate governance is a big issue. So again, it's a great macro story, but getting managements that you want to invest in is not easy. So we've never had actually any allocation to the real estate sector. And I don't foresee them coming in the portfolio over the next few years.
Just to add to what Nilesh said, but Nilesh, we do have indirect exposures to cement and materials as a
HDFC,
sector.
HDFC,
there are proxy plays to the real estate sector. So we own two mortgage finance companies, which of course, as the real estate sector grows, they will do a lot better. Again, these are very safe mortgage finance companies owned by great managements and or sovereign owned. Then we have cement companies, which again, as the economy develops and people build more houses, will tend to do well. So there is proxy to real estate that we own, but direct real estate companies we do not.
Thanks, Nilesh. Chirag, quickly, how do you justify the higher PE of the ESG fund?
So ESG is looking at companies, which are quality companies, which are kind of good at their practices. And usually these kind of quality companies generally trade at a premium. But if you look at the earnings growth of these companies, they're still very, very, very high. So we look at how the companies are in terms of their ESG practices, what kind of quality do they have, even on the governance standards. And we are looking at, are they financially stable or not? If the company meets these two criteria, we will invest in those companies irrespective of the valuation. So so we do invest in such companies. Again, the weight of the company is also decided based on its ESG score that kind of reflects it, though there are sector and company level weight guardrails. But beyond that, if the company fulfills its quality check in terms of ESG practices, and it has a financial soundness, stability along with it, we will invest in those companies. But we've seen that these kind of companies are ahead of the curve. They kind of are ready for the next disruption, and therefore tied well over cycles. And though today on a historical basis, the PE looks expensive, but if you look at the consensus growth estimates of these companies, they are much better. So on a PEG ratio basis, which is PE adjusted for growth, it is still cheaper as compared to the index.
Thank you. And one final question for you, Arvind. Looking at the current market situation, if there was one piece of advice you had to give investors, what would that be?
My one piece of advice is keep it simple. You know, so it's good to know, good to understand, good to read, good to analyze, and then make your investments. But investing is not what you are meant to do. Like, you have a life to live, you have a job to do, you have a family, and investing is for your safety, for your diversification, and for your wealth creation. And that's how it should be. So if you keep it simple, which is why we came about with this 20-20, right? We realized a lot of investors are trying to relative returns, right? Well, that fund made 12%, this fund is making 14%, do I need to shift? No, all those kinds of, it creates problems. It makes your life a bit more complex. If you keep it simple, you let your money do what you do, keep your allocation, choose good products, good simple funds where you can trust your money with, right? You need to figure out managers and AMCs or banks where you can trust your money, and keep it simple, live your life, and let your wealth and your financial, let the, you know, asset management companies and banks do what they're supposed to do. So my mantra is always just keep it simple.
Thank you, Arvind, for those words. With that last question, we have come to the end of this webinar. Though we have tried to cover as many questions as possible, we'd love to hear from you. So please feel free to reach out to us on our website, www.quantumemc.com, and our customer care team will get back to you. For those interested, the recording of the webinar will be shared on email and will also be put up on our official YouTube channel. Finally, a big thank you to our experts for being here today. And thank you to all our investors for joining in. I wish all of you a very happy and prosperous new year on behalf of Team Quantum. Good night.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.